half hour or so, I'm going to present
Hello, welcome to part 15 of the cause of the AIDS epidemic. I'm Dr. Ramesh Senewiratne, and in this episode, I'm going to revisit some of the Scientific American articles in this special issue of the Scientific American from 1988 about what was being claimed by the American establishment and the senior figures in the AIDS establishment about the cause of the AIDS epidemic, its demographics, and what can be done about the epidemic. These are the annual reports that I've been using to explain the role that Australian institutions have played in the development of AIDS treatment strategies. I should mention that the McFarlane-Bennett Centre, or the Bennett Institute's primary research aim is development not just of AIDS drugs, but of a mythical AIDS vaccine. And John Mills is on record as saying that a AIDS vaccine based on the HIV virus itself could be used in Thailand and other countries with a high incidence of AIDS, even though initially it is likely to cause AIDS itself. This is in line with some vaccine research that is being done at the John Curtin School of Medicine at the Australian National University. You may remember that John Curtin, the Labour Prime Minister of the Second World War, was also a Freemason. The Australian National University John Curtin School of Medicine has also was in the news for developing a vaccine change, a genetically engineering mousepox vaccine, such that it caused sudden immune collapse of the mice. And this was reported a couple of years ago by the Murdoch Press. Here you can see the annual reports of the Murdoch Children's Research Institute, which is a children's genetics research institute, and its location at the Royal Children's Hospital. The annual report of the Baker Research Institute. And we looked last time at the annual report of Orica and the boss of Orica is also the boss of the Mental Health Research Institute in Parkville. And as we saw last time, Orica is a major supplier of explosives and cyanide for the mining industry and do not declare in its annual reports any sales that end up in other explosives for the weapons industry. But the history of Imperial Chemical Industries, or ICI, is that the ammonium nitrate, which was used to make TNT and gunpowder, was sold not just to the mining industry but also to all the sources that the British Empire sold weapons to. This is a modern educational map of the world, or provided by an education company, and it gives the changes in the names of various parts of the world in recent years. I'll shortly be comparing this map with the old colonized world and the maps of the world under the Second World War, domination of the Allies and Japan and Germany. This is, of course, where the AIDS epidemic began, in the Congo, and Democratic Republic of Congo, which was previously known as Zaire. Kinshasa, as I recall, used to be Leopoldville, named after King Leopold of Belgium, who acquired the Congo, which, as you can see, is several times the size of Belgium, and acquired it in the late 1800s and held it as a personal slave colony right up until 1905 or 1906, when, due to complaints by the British that there were atrocities in Belgium under King Leopold's rule, the British Empire pressured the Belgian government to take over Leopold's Congo. And subsequently, the Congo was expanded, or the Belgian possessions were expanded in the Congo, to include the small states of Rwanda and Burundi, which were early epicenters of the epidemic in the early 1980s. Rwanda and Burundi and Uganda were previously possessions of Germany in Africa, but after the Second World War, when Belgium allied itself with England, after being colonized by the Germans, the British granted Belgium control of Zaire, or the Congo, and Burundi and Rwanda, while they took control of Uganda. And when Uganda achieved independence, it was ruled very cruelly by Idi Amin. As you can see from these maps of the growth of the British Empire, by the time the Second World War came around, as a failure of the League of Nations to keep peace between the European powers, Britain owned or controlled much of Africa, and the French controlled much of West Africa. All the red section were the British colony, ranging from South Africa all the way up to British Somalia and what is now Ethiopia. The Italians also had an interest in colonizing Northern Africa, but the British also by then controlled much of Asia, and also behind the scenes, a lot of the events in Canada, North America, Australia, and New Zealand. the center of British power in the Americas was in the West Indies, which were largely British colonies after they were taken over from the Spanish. The Spanish, of course, used the West Indies as slave colonies, and so did the British. And the slaves were taken from mainly West Africa and Central Africa, including the Belgian Congo and Angola, but particularly Nigeria and the Congo and Ghana and what used to be called Slave Coast, which was adjacent to the Ivory Coast and the Grain Coast. This atlas is from during the Second World War and gives a map of Canaan as divided among the 12 tribes in the Bible, or the Old Testament of the Bible, which, as you can see, includes much of Jordan and some of Egypt and all of Palestine. And Palestine today, meaning Palestine during the Second World War and before the formation of Israel. Here you can see in more detail the names of the European colonization of Africa. Egypt had been the site of a battle between the French and the British for power, and the financing of the Suez Canal, which made Egypt even more valuable than it already was by a French company, and using Egyptian labor. However, the British purchased shares of the Suez Canal with finance from the Anglo-Jewish American Rothschild family. And the Rothschilds also provided the funding for Cecil Rhodes, who was a lawyer as well as a future Prime Minister of South Africa, but mainly known for his diamond empire and naming Rhodesia after himself. Cecil Rhodes had a plan of building a colony that stretched all the way from Egypt to the Cape of Good Hope. He had a plan of building a railway and roads that would carry the gold and diamonds from South Africa through Kenya or British East Africa all the way to the Mediterranean Ocean. Cape Town and Cape of Good Hope, of course, were important British ports prior to opening the Suez Canal in the 1800s. And up till then, all European ships to get to India and the Spice Islands had to sail around the southern coast of Africa. You can see there that Nigeria and France, Belgium and Portugal were the countries that had colonized all of Africa prior to the Second World War and during the Second World War. All of these African countries were granted independence in the period from 1950 to 1970,
And this followed the formation of the United Nations organization, which had a mandate to decolonize the countries that had been European powers after the horrors of the Second World War. Here you can see the map that includes Manchuria or Manchukuo province of China, which was the Japanese colonization as Japan imitated the Europeans in seizing other countries as part of an empire. And this brought it, Japan, which had been previously regarded as honorary whites in South Africa and by the British Empire, it brought Japan into conflict with both the Freemasons, headed by Winston Churchill and Roosevelt, and Menzies in Australia, and into conflict between England and the center of the Masonic Empire, and Germany, which was allied with Spain and Italy, and Japan. These were called the Axis powers, while England and America regarded themselves or called themselves the Allies. And people from the Asian and Australian colonies of England were, and particularly young boys and young men, were sent to the front lines to protect the British Empire. And this had been similarly the case in the First World War, when, of course, Australia sent many young boys to die in Turkey, in Gallipoli. These photographs from the Penguin publication, The Chronicle of the World, and a photograph of Winston Churchill meeting Roosevelt and Stalin, Truman, sorry. And Truman was a Freemason along with Roosevelt. And here, the casualties of the war, few people know anything about 10 million Chinese dying in the Second World War. However, the figures that are provided and all the information that is provided in this huge book is laden with British propaganda. The stories are presented as if they are contemporary news stories. Year by year, from the prehistoric times in the Chronicle series. But the photographs are excellent, and present in themselves a historical perspective of the amount of militarization that occurred in the 1940s. Throughout the world, and the behavior of the Freemasons during this time, and it's important to remember that the leaders, the political leaders of England and America and Australia were all Freemasons during the Second World War. And the head of the Freemasons is a member of the royal family. And this is an intensely royalist organization that previously presided over the slave trade. The Freemasons were the masters of the British ships, as well as the masters of the British construction of cathedrals for the Anglican Church. And they call themselves masters, grandmasters, supreme masters, supreme commanders, and so on. And were involved in the people who were giving the orders to the entire military and police systems in the old feudal and colonial and imperial British Empire. The senior members of Masonry, which is not mentioned at all in this Penguin publication, the senior members of the Freemasons were basically rich old men, and they met in lodges throughout the British Empire and used women during their wars to provide support for the war effort. While they used the people of the world, and particularly black people and poor people, to die in their battles to control more and more land and resources. This is a October 1988 issue of Scientific American, and it was given to me by a psychology student in the University of Melbourne. And here you can see a significant article by Robert Gallo and Luc Montagnier. He talks about therapy or vaccine, by which he means drug therapy. It's not talking about holistic improvement in people's health. Max Essex, and that's a African green monkey, I believe. And the epidemiology of AIDS in the United States, and then the international epidemiology is written by Peter Peel and Jonathan Mann. As you'll remember, Peter Peel replaced Jonathan Mann as the head of UN AIDS after Jonathan Mann's premature death. And Peter Peel has recently made predictions reported in the Age newspaper in Melbourne, the Fairfax Press, that the AIDS epidemic is about to explode in China and Russia. They made previous predictions about India and Thailand in particular, Southeast Asia. And you'll see, you would have seen in the previous 2 hours that the McFarlane-Burnett Center continued to behave in their treatment strategies as if the main problem in these countries is injecting drug use and prostitution, when in fact injecting drug use is not part of the culture of the third world generally, except where it has been introduced by the Americans, and particularly Vietnam and Korea. But the creation of a narcotic, an opiate-dependent population in the Third World and the First World was created by the British Empire in what are now known as the Opium Wars of the 1840s. And at that stage, Britain and America had established themselves as the centers of the opium trade and also the alcohol trade. You'll note the various companies that were advertising in this 1988 Scientific American publication, and a range of international companies, but many with connections with history, historical connections with the eugenics movement and the German Nazis. Now, Luc Montagnier and Robert Gallo write about retroviruses, but they fail to mention the real history of the discovery of retroviruses, and there is no mention at all of the interest of the military establishment in America in all viruses, including and especially viruses that cause cancer. And here you see the only drug company ad in this issue. And this is Bayer, which have a history of complicity again in the eugenics movement. The authors of all the articles in this, with the exception of Peter Peel, are American researchers, several from Harvard, Lufthansa. And the origins of the AIDS epidemic by Max Essex, who was a co-colleague of Robert Gallo. And they give the impression that it's well established that HIV came from green monkeys, and they even have a photograph of a green monkey, but they do not mention from the Harvard School of Public Health the history of Harvard University in promoting the eugenics movement throughout the world, and the role of Harvard University in supporting biological warfare research from the time that biological warfare research was first done in America. Because, of course, Harvard was founded in the 1600s and was the oldest, or is the oldest, of the American universities. Here you can see that HIV, back in 1988, had been injected into a whole range of primates to see which of them would get HTLV, HIV-1, and HIV-2. So obviously the argument that finding HIV in the liver of a chimpanzee in the American Air Force bases or stored specimens in Africa or anywhere else cannot reasonably be used to refute the idea that HIV is the result of biological warfare and the implication of a genocidal program. Here is a map of the incidence of HIV-2 in prostitutes, they call sex workers, in various parts of Africa. And you can see a huge number of prostitutes in Senegal, which was a French colony. And there's a perspective presented of the epidemiology in the US that is best understood by the photograph that they make a point is not provided by CDC or the Centers for Disease Control. And they say that the blacks and Hispanics are particular targets. And the authors are from the Centers of Disease Control in Atlanta. And the photograph is accompanied by some maps of the demographics of the AIDS epidemic in the 1980s in America, with the purple and red areas showing the areas of highest incidence. So you can see that there were epicenters in New York in particular. Delaware and Maryland are centers of the chemical and biological and conventional weapons production facilities in the United States. Here you can see a comparison between homosexual, heterosexual, IV drug users and various groups, including receivers of transfusions. In the American demographics, this is apparently a child with AIDS, a 5-year-old AIDS patient. It doesn't look anything like a 5-year-old child, and it's still wearing nappies. And these are the demographics of the AIDS epidemic in the United States at the time. You can see the steady increase in numbers. And here we have a comparison between white, black, and Hispanic populations and their proportional incidence of HIV. You can see that blacks and Hispanics are disproportionately represented. Since that time, the biggest growing population of AIDS sufferers in America are no longer white homosexuals, but young black women of childbearing age. And here we have the article that is authored by Peter Peel, amongst other authors, including Jonathan Mann, and the World Health Organization's Global AIDS Program, which was renamed the UN AIDS. UN AIDS has a budget of billions of dollars, supposedly to treat AIDS. But the evidence that I've provided in these 15 episodes of The Cause of the AIDS Epidemic suggests that these billions of dollars are being used to kill people while making a great deal of money and also setting up an infrastructure for surveillance and slavery of black people in Africa and throughout the world. You'll note that the parade here of people who are supposedly from Uganda are carrying a purple cross, and of course, Christianity was introduced to Africa by the European colonizers. Here, you can see that the demographics of AIDS in Africa, the epidemic followed, according to Scientific American, the epidemic in North America. And at that time, they divided into pattern 1, pattern 2, pattern 3 on not reporting, and HIV 2. Pattern 1 was homosexuals and drug users, or spread by homosexuals and drug users. Pattern 2 was a heterosexual disease. HIV 2 was largely confined to Portuguese and French colonies in Africa, in the West Coast and the East Coast. And Australia had the pattern one along with all of North America and South America. However, the demographics have changed significantly since 1988, in the last 17 years. Here, you notice a significant variation between the concentration of AIDS in various parts of the Caribbean. And the area that was British Guiana, which is located in purple, which was a British colony and the only British colony in South America, had a high concentration of AIDS, unlike its neighbors. Some of this is attributed by the authorities to a lack of reporting or increased reporting. And of course, it is quite true that the more you test people for HIV, the more people will come and test as positive. The problem is that all tests have got false positive incidences. And if you widely screen a large population will test positive. If automatically these people are then started onto a cytotoxic drug or a series of drugs that are cytotoxic, then of course one will create collapse of the immune system and AIDS. The real management of the public health that is needed is fresh food, fresh water, ability to earn a living, clothes, a nice place to live, and the ability to see plants and animals when one looks out of one's window. These are all possible for all the countries of the Third World, but they have never been the agenda for the Third World of the bankers in the First World and the kings and queens of the European royal family that divided the world amongst themselves in the period from 1500 to 1945 or 1950. Now we have the United States of America claiming to be the world's only superpower, whatever that means. I think they may have watched too many Superman movies. One will remember that the concept of a Superman was a German concept that was written about by Nietzsche and was taken up by the Nazis as well. And being better than everyone else is something that was deeply ingrained into Masonic thinking and is reflected in the culture of the American and British and Australian political systems. This atlas is a 1970s Jacaranda school atlas, authored by some retired teachers and principals of Brisbane High School, Corinda High School, and also in New South Wales. Here you can see that the countries that were previously named Gold Coast have become Ghana, Slave Coast has become Benin. And the Congo and Kinshasa were then, or the Congo was called Zaire, and Rhodesia has been divided into Zimbabwe and Zambia. During this time, the white South African regime, or the apartheid regime, which is often blamed by the British on the Dutch or Afrikaners, was in fact very much a British idea and supported by all the white Europeans, but it was the British who instituted concentration camps to kill the Dutch during the Boer War in South Africa and maintained control of the infrastructure of Cape Town and the Southern Cape of Africa from the time of Cecil Rhodes right up until the present day. The center of this wealth that the British have maintained in South Africa is centered on minerals, and particularly gold and silver and uranium and diamonds. And here you can see in 1970 the Australian school atlases were telling children about the divisions between the Bantu or the blacks, African blacks and coloureds, Asiatics and whites. This was not the situation in school atlases in other parts of the world. But Australia had a particular affinity with the apartheid regime in white South Africa, because it itself was trying to create a white colony in Australia. You can see that much more detail is provided about apartheid South Africa than any other part of Africa in this Australian school atlas. They talk about division of segregated areas of residence and also of depopulation of the white areas and relative increases in black populations. This is the kind of mentality that makes it easy to believe that the social architects and public health architects and behavior architects who divided the people along their skin color and their race in this way could also decide to kill people also according to their skin color. You'll notice the location of the black areas in the areas that have been designated for mining. And theoretical models of urban functional structure. And all of that detail is provided for high school students, or was provided in the 1970s and 1980s. And you can see, understandably, lots of maps of Australia, but very few maps of Africa or Asia or South America, apart from a large number of maps of South Africa itself, and particularly the race-related areas of South Africa. Now, Palmerston Crescent, South Melbourne, is and was the location of the Royal College of General Practitioners and the Medical Board of Victoria and a Masonic Center in South Melbourne. It remains the home of the Royal College of General Practitioners. Now, all the medical Royal Colleges were established by Freemasons, and in fact the first Royal College of Physicians in England was established by none other than Henry VIII, who founded the Anglican Church or the Church of England as early as the 1500s. Britain continued using slave labor and continued slavery of black people for another 300 years after that. And it shouldn't surprise anyone to believe that the people who were prepared to sell black people and kill them with infected blankets and chain their own people to barges and send them to the other side of the world as slaves for stealing a loaf of bread or a towel, that these people could also be guilty of premeditated genocide, and that their descendants could continue this policy of genocide. You can see the detailed maps of land use of Victoria and some satellite photographs of Melbourne and the Port Phillip Bay. This is a more recent Melway street directory, and if you compare it with the street directory images of the 1993 street directory that we looked at a couple of hours ago, you'll see the developments of the Burnet Institute and how Melbourne has been developed in the last 10 years in response to the AIDS epidemic and the global war on terrorism, and also in an effort to win more money and grants from frightening the public about illness and car accidents and warfare and terrorists and biological war and chemical warfare and Islamic fundamentalists. And here you can see that what was previously the Royal School for Deaf Children is the Victorian School for Deaf Children. The Royal Freemasons Homes is still there, and the Baker Institute had not yet been located to its new location east of the Alfred Hospital in a multi-million dollar project, redevelopment project, which is the big blank area in the middle of the screen. This is where the McFarlane Burnet Center have built their $60 million extravaganza to advise the poor people of the world on how best to prevent AIDS, and you can see another view of the new Burnet building. And it was then near its completion. It is now complete, and there are people working inside there. And I hope that over the last 6 hours, I have been able to present enough of the information that you've been able to read enough of the information to keep pursuing the evidence that I have been collecting with my partner Sarah over the past 10 years. about biological and chemical warfare and the roots of the chemical and biological warfare institutions in Australia and the world.